All right. Hey there, guys. In this video, I want to talk about research ethics, and it's a little bit of a crash course in being an ethical practitioner researcher. So this is somebody who is applying research in their work practice to improve what they do in a workplace or investigating their workplace or whatever. So the idea of ethics and questions of ethical responsibility have been around basically since people discovered fire. Their essence is essentially the question of how to live. And something that's been grappled with by like ancient philosophers from Socrates, Plato, Confucius, the Epicureans and the Stoics, all the way through Christian theologians like Augustine and Aquinas and Enlightenment philosophers like Immanuel Kant, and even shows like The Good Place today. I think if you really want to show that grapples with ethics in a really neat and engaging way, it's worth watching The Good Place. It's on Netflix. Chidi is an ethics professor, and I think he unpacks a whole lot of these really neat little issues about what it takes to be a good person. My personal favorite ethical text is Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics, which sets out the ways that a person can better themselves and become more virtuous. But it's just one amidst a million complex takes on what makes a person ethical. When it comes to research ethics, we're basically talking about a question of how to be ethical. How do we relate in a good and appropriate way with people who might be joining us in our research? And that applies as much to academic research as it does to the sort of stuff we might do in our workplace to improve our practice. Just as teachers who are doing research on their own classrooms would do, they need to consider the ethics of dealing with students, dealing with their colleagues. And I really like this statement from the National Health and Medical Research Council, the National Statement on Ethical Conduct in Human Research, which basically says all human interaction, including the interaction involved in human research, has ethical dimensions. However, ethical conduct is more than simply doing the right thing. It involves acting in the right spirit out of an abiding respect and concern for one's fellow creatures. So I think what I love about this statement is that it sort of highlights the fact that anything we do has ethical dimensions. It's not just about what is right and wrong, which might be more of a moral question, but about how we relate to other people, how we conduct ourselves, who we are as people, and how we see that in relationship to the world around us. So I think ethical is a really rich take on what it means to be a person. Now, research ethics has grown as a concern over the past 100 years, but particularly after the Second World War, when the Nazi medical experiments came to light during that period. In 1964, the World Medical Assembly adopted a thing called the Helsinki Declaration, which emphasizes the importance of human beings and our lives and our dignity. And over time, these principles have been expanded to all kinds of research that might involve people and all the different aspects in which ethical concerns can appear. This might include in the context of the research, where it's being conducted and in what environment it's being conducted, the people involved and whether they're from a vulnerable group in particular. But it doesn't just have to be people from a vulnerable group. All people might be made vulnerable by the nature of research. The procedures involved in the research, this is really important. The data that will be collected and stored and how it might be used and how long it will be stored for and who it will be available to. The methods involved in the research, and this is really significant. A lot of these initial ethical concerns came out of medicine, where it was a question of what can you do to experiment on a human being and what is justified. And of course, publishing and sharing. So who is going to read the findings of this research? So these are really complicated elements of ethics, but it's just important to remember that there are ethical concerns in all different aspects of research. So in Australia, these principles are codified in a document called the National Statement on Ethical Conduct in Human Research. So this was developed by the National Health Medical Research Council, the NHMRC, the Australian Research Council, and Universities Australia. And it's a really rich and detailed document that outlines a set of guidelines for the ethical conduct of research. I think it's really useful also to read it in conjunction with the guidelines for ethical conduct in research with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples and communities. They're two separate documents that deal with two very, very important elements of ethical conduct. But one of the easiest ways I can think of to understand these guidelines is through the lens of some of the most unethical people out there, and that would be Disney villains. So let me introduce to you the ethical guidelines and principles from the NHMRC statement, courtesy of Disney villain Evil. So the first of these values is merit and integrity. So research has to be justifiable by its potential benefits. There has to be some merit to the research. It has to be conducted for a good reason and a good purpose. It has to have respect for its participants. And it also has to be rigorous. It can't just be sort of inane garbage. So let's have a look at how ISMA conducts non-meritorious and research lacking integrity.
Ah, how shall I do it? Oh, I know. I'll turn him into a flea. a harmless little flea. And then I'll put that flea in a box, and then I'll put that box inside of another box, and then I'll mail that box to myself. And when it arrives, I'll smash it with a hammer! It's brilliant, 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 I tell you! Genius, I say!
So I think this really sums it up, right? Why was Yzma trying to turn the emperor into a llama? Why this elaborate process? If you've seen The Emperor's New Groove, you know this person just has no, there's no integrity whatsoever to the way she conducts herself. She turns the emperor into a llama, and the question is sort of like, does that have merit or integrity? No, it's just a vengeful mission. But it also has no empirical justification. There's no legitimate research question that needs answering. And I think when you're thinking about merit integrity, you need to bear in mind it's all about having a justification and legitimacy to the research that you're doing. It's all about the solid planning and justification that goes into your research. The next guideline relates to justice. This is about fair recruitment of participants, and that you're not unfairly burdening participants with anything, and that you're not exploiting people who join you in your research. Fair recruitment is really important. You can't sort of coerce people into it. And I think let's have a look at a clip here from Scar.
All the more reason for me to be protective. An elephant graveyard is no place for a young prince. Oops.
An elephant what? Whoa.
Oh, dear, I've said too much. Well, I suppose you'd have found out sooner or later. You being so clever and all. Well, just do me one favor. Promise me you'll never visit that dreadful place.
No problem.
There's a good lad. You run along now and have fun. And remember, it's our little secret.
So, in the main, Scar kind of recruits unfairly the entire pride into his plans, and it's not just at all. There's no justice about it. But I think when you're looking at that little clip of the way he interacts with Simba, it's also about the fact that he's exploiting his youth, his lack of understanding about the world. So Scar clearly has ulterior motives here, and there's no justice to what he does. But that's essentially what The Lion King is all about. So I guess in considering justice, you need to remember that you're not being too demanding on participants in your research, and that you're being fair in the way you recruit them into the research. The next guideline relates to beneficence and risk. And so that is, not only does there need to be a sort of kind intent behind research, which is the beneficence part, the opposite of maleficent, you know, wonderful Disney villain, but also, if there is going to be risk, that it's justifiable. Obviously, some research can have risk. At the moment, they're doing, you know, vaccine trials for COVID-19. Now, it's not to say they're going to give people an unsafe vaccine, but there are some risks inherent with trying a new drug that's on the market. They're testing it to see the effects that it will have on humans. And so, therefore, there's some justifiable risk, even if it's minimal risk. But they acknowledge that, and they have ways of moderating and mediating that risk. So the importance with beneficence as risk is considering minimizing discomfort, minimizing inconvenience, and any justified potential harm, but you must be able to justify it. And that involves a cost-benefit analysis. Like you're making sure that the benefits of the research outweigh the costs, and you really need to weigh those costs with human considerations in mind and guarantee the safety of participants in your research.
And to show I bear no ill will, I too shall bestow a gift on the child. Listen well, all of you. The princess shall indeed grow in grace and beauty, beloved by all who know her. But before the sun sets on her 16th birthday, she shall prick her finger on the spindle of a spinning wheel and die.
So the thing that you need to bear in mind here is that research, the stuff that research achieves, must on balance justify any risk that it involves. Maleficent is arguably the total opposite of beneficent. The gift that she's giving Princess Aurora here, that she'll be stunningly beautiful, the most beautiful princess in the kingdom, in history even, but that she'll prick her thumb on the thimble of a spinning wheel and die, that's not justifiable risk. The risk is death. It's an extreme risk. Classroom research obviously is less extreme, but you do also need to pay attention to like whether students are going to miss out, whether they'll feel alienated by research, whether advantaging one classroom with one intervention or thing that you're trying in one classroom disadvantages another. So it's really important to think about those issues. So research really needs to have regard for privacy, people's right to choose, and respect for their beliefs, customs, and cultural heritage. Let's have a look at classic bro Gaston and see how he approaches the issue of privacy and cultural sensitivity and respect.
Hello, Belle.
Bonjour, Gaston. Gaston, may I have my book, please?
How can you read this? There's no pictures.
Well, some people use their imagination.
Belle, it's about time you got your head out of those books and paid attention to more important things. Like me. The whole town's talking about it. It's not right for a woman to read. Soon she starts getting ideas and thinking.
Gaston, you are positively primeval.
Why, thank you, Belle. What do you say you and me take a walk over to the tavern and take a look at my trophies?
Maybe some other time.
What's wrong with her?
She's crazy.
He's gorgeous.
Please, Gaston, I can't. I have to get home to help my father. Goodbye.
That crazy old loon, he needs all the help he can get.
Don't talk about my father that way.
Yeah, don't talk about her father that way.
My father is not crazy. He's a genius.
So Gaston is not only an insensitive jerk, he doesn't really respect Belle's rights to privacy. He intervenes with her family environment. He grabs a book and he's tossing it in the mud. He doesn't respect the privacy and cultural norms of the beast and his castle, if you get later in the film. So, of course, it's pretty ethically dubious when he chooses to invade the castle with a fire and pitchfork, but I think you can see it in Gaston's general character that he's got no attention to this particular ethical guideline. The next two guidelines are really central to the structure of research in that you need to ensure anonymity, confidentiality, and that people have agreed to participate in the research. So as far as anonymity and confidentiality goes, it's really important, especially when you're reporting research, that identities are kept hidden from the researcher, ideally, which is anonymity. That's very difficult in a classroom situation where you might be working on your own practice with a class of kids that you know, in which case it's really important that you don't disclose the identities of participants to anybody else, which would be confidentiality. Let's have a look at an example from Aladdin.
Oh, princess, there's someone I'm dying to introduce you to.
Jafar, get your hands off her!
Prince Ali, yes, it is he, but not as you know him. Read my lips and come to grips with reality. What? Yes, meet a blast from your past, whose lies were too good to last. Say hello to your precious Prince Ali!
Or should we say, Aladdin?
So even though you could argue that Aladdin has also deceived Princess Jasmine here, so there's his own questions about honesty and respect, that doesn't necessarily deny the fact that Jafar here is being very unethical. He doesn't respect Prince Ali's privacy. He reveals his identity to the entire society of Agrabah. Massive ethical violation. Of course, you could also regard turning into a giant snake, accruing all of the powers of the world's most powerful sorcerer, becoming this unbelievably powerful genie as an even greater ethical violation. And most importantly, informed consent must be sought from participants. And that is that participants in research need to have a right to make informed decisions. They need to enter the research of their free will and with an understanding of the study process. They need to know all about the potential benefits, but also the dangers that you've identified as you've gone through these ethical guidelines.
Let her go.
Not a chance, Triton. She's mine now. We made a deal.
Daddy, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
You see? The contract's legal, binding, and completely unbreakable. Even for you. Of course, I always was a girl with an eye for a bargain.
So if you consider this clip here, which is, you know, Ursula sort of bringing home the bacon against King Triton, she didn't really give Ariel informed consent. There was a coercive element in the signing of the contract. She sung a really good song, Poor Unfortunate Souls. And so there's also a question about justice, right? And I think with a lot of these ethical questions, they overlap with each other, these guidelines. So Ursula's breached a whole lot of ethical principles, but most significantly with this contract, she hasn't fully given Ariel the ability to consent. If she hasn't been properly informed about the details of the contract that she's entered into, it's not a legitimate consent because she hasn't been fully informed. So that's Disney villain ethics 101, merit and integrity, beneficence and risk, anonymity and confidentiality, justice, respect, privacy, and cultural sensitivity, and informed consent. How these get activated in the classroom is also really interesting, because it's not just I'm doing a research project and I want to talk about research ethics in this way. Mockler writes a really interesting article about how research ethics can become everyday ethics, and I'll link to it in the description of this video. But basically, she extrapolates some of these ethical principles into what she calls everyday ethics in the context of a classroom. So for people conducting practitioner research and looking at ways to improve their practice, these principles apply pretty much in day-to-day life. Mockler describes 5 critical dimensions. The first is, of course, informed consent. The second is the notion that we do no harm, which is something that as teachers we should be familiar with anyway. The third is privileging participants' voices, and that's actually about stepping away from you as a dominating powerful figure as a researcher and allowing participants' voices, whether that's students, whether that's colleagues, to speak from the research and to basically give them a platform to be more heard than your own interpretations. Understanding power dynamics is the fourth and I think a really critical dimension as well. Researchers and teachers have a huge amount of power in a classroom, and that can lead to sort of coercive circumstances where people feel like they're obliged to participate in research. So it's something that you need to be mindful of. And the last is exercising sound judgment, which is essentially about making sure that what you are doing is the right thing to do in a given circumstance with due regard for all of these other ethical considerations. So I think this video is getting a little long, so we'll stop there and then we'll have a part 2, which will look at research with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples and communities. There's a really beautiful framework that's been created around ethical conduct there, and then maybe a couple of other examples of ethical research or unethical research that have been conducted in the past that's worth looking at. So I'll see you at part 2.